Good morning, sixth graders. I hope you're doing well. Welcome back to week six of online learning. This is the last week that we'll be reading fictional texts that cover the theme of horror. And we're also going to be reading from the Goosebumps series. The title of the text that we will be reading is The Haunted Mask. We're just going to watch a video that's going to recap a certain comprehension skill that we have learned. Try to guess which comprehension skill is being targeted. Saw one domino piece affected the entire thing to come falling down. So what do you think the comprehension skill of this week is going to be? Cause and effect. So this week we'll only be reviewing last week's comprehension skill, and we'll also be learning two more things that you're going to be seeing in the text later. A cause is an event, action or feeling that makes something happen, as we know. An effect is the result of that cause, it's what happens. Identifying the causes and effects can help you see the logical order of what you are reading, and can help you better understand why events occur. Here are some steps in identifying causes and effects. Circle an important event that takes place in a passage. This may be your effect. Ask yourself questions such as, why did this event happen? And what led up to this event? Look for signal words or transitions such as because, since, due to. Causes and effects in Wonder. Let's look at some examples of causes and effects in this week's assigned pages. Use signal words as you think about the following questions. Augie said that he did not exactly know why, but Via and him piled up Daisy's toys on a coffee table and stared at them. Why do you think they did that? Why did Daisy bite Mom's arm? Why did their previous argument not matter anymore? Why does it matter to August whether or not people look the same in heaven? So think about all these four questions and think about what the causes behind these events might be. Take your time, pause the video. When you're done thinking about them, come back. So why Augie and Via piled up all of Daisy's toys on the coffee table is because they did that as a small tribute, appreciation of Daisy's existence in their lives and their memories together. Of course, you may have a different answer, but this is my interpretation. Why did Daisy bite Mom's arm? She was not being herself that day. She bit Mom because she was in extreme pain. The previous argument did not matter anymore because it seemed very minute compared to the loss of Daisy. It mattered to August that people did not look the same in heaven, because August most probably would not want to be stuck with his earthly face up in heaven. The second two things that we will be covering this week, you're going to find them in the text later on and in the questions. So the first thing is called mood. Let's see what mood is. Mood is referred to the atmosphere of a literary piece, of any text, as it creates the emotional setting that surrounds the readers. Mood is created through various methods, including the setting, tone, and diction. Let's see what these three are. So there can be different kinds of moods to every kind of text. First thing is the setting. Through the setting, the writer can create the mood of the text. It is the physical location in a piece of literature that provides background. Second way that the writer can create the mood is the tone. The tone is the way or manner in which the author writes. It is the attitude of the writer, the way the writer feels about the events. And the last way that the writer can create the mood of the text is diction. Diction is the choice of words the writer uses. Now you try. We're going to look into three examples and you try to think what the mood is of the text. Example 1 is from Pickwick Papers by Charles Dickens. The river, reflecting the clear blue of the sky, glistened and sparkled as it flowed noiselessly on. What do you think the mood of this text, of this sentence, is? Charles Dickens creates a calm and peaceful mood. Example number 2, Wuthering Heights by Emily Brontë. There was no moon, and everything beneath lay in misty darkness. Not a light gleamed from any house, far or near, all had been extinguished long ago, and those at Wuthering Heights were never visible. What kind of mood is the author creating through this statement? She is creating a depressing mood whenever Wuthering Heights is described. And the last example is from The Road Not Taken by Robert Frost. I shall be telling this with a sigh. Somewhere ages and ages hence, two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by. And that has made all the difference. So look into the words, especially focus on the word sigh. What do you think the mood of this paragraph is? Frost informs us about his past with a sigh that gives the above lines an unhappy tone and thus evokes an unhappy mood. An unhappy mood is created because the poet convinces us that he regrets a choice he made in the past. So that covers up mood. The second literary element that we will be covering that you will also find later in the questions is imagery. Imagery means to use figurative language to represent objects, actions, and ideas in such a way that it appeals to our physical five senses. So let's read the following examples of imagery carefully and see which sense they touch upon. Number 1. It was dark and dim in the forest. So the words dark and dim are visual images. They appeal the sense of sight. Number 2. The children were screaming and shouting in the fields. Screaming and shouting appeal to our sense of hearing or auditory sense. 3. He whiffed the aroma of brewed coffee. Whiff and aroma evoke our sense of smell. 4. The girl ran her hands on a soft satin fabric. The idea of soft in this example appeals to our sense of touch. 5. The fresh and juicy orange is very cold and sweet. Juicy and sweet, when associated with oranges, have an effect on our sense of taste. Now you're going to try with practicing imagery. We're going to see an example titled Daffodils by William Wordsworth. I wandered lonely as a cloud that floats on high over vales and hills, when all at once I saw a crowd, a host of golden daffodils, beside the lake, beneath the trees, fluttering and dancing in the breeze. So look at the words being used by the author. What sense does it appeal to? And which words do you think appeals to the senses? The poet uses the sense of sight to create a host of golden daffodils beside the lake. Their fluttering and dancing also refers to the sight. So what do you think is the function of imagery? Why do writers use imagery in their texts? Let's see. The function of imagery in literature is to generate a vibrant presentation of a scene that appeals to as many of the reader's senses as possible. It aids and helps the reader's imagination to envision and imagine the characters and scenes in the literary piece clearly. That's it for all the skills covered in this week for comprehension. Let's look into what we're reading today. We're also going to be reading from the Goosebumps series. As I said, it is titled as The Haunted Mask. It is the 11th book in Goosebumps, the series of children's horror fiction novels created and written by R.L. Stein. What is it about? The book follows Carly Beth, a girl who buys a Halloween mask from a store. After putting on the mask, she starts acting differently and discovers that the mask has become her face. She's unable to pull the mask off. So you're only going to be reading the first part of this book. It's also an excerpt. And also, guys, you're not going to be reading exactly. This week, we're going to be listening and trying to improve our listening skills. So it's going to be a recording of a person reading the chapter to you. R.L. Stein says he got the idea of the book from his son who had put on a Halloween mask he had trouble getting off. Happy listening!